At this time, I would like to introduce to you our associate pastor, Pastor Tony Samuels.
Hallelujah. Amen. You can be seated. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't want to delay. Let's get right into the word. If you could get out your Bible and go to the book of Malachi, chapter number 3. Malachi, chapter number 3. Amen. How y'all doing this morning? Amen. Hallelujah. Malachi chapter number 3. Let's start at verse 6. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. For I am the Lord, and I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob are not consumed. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you this morning, Lord, for the awesome opportunity to minister your word. And Father God, I ask right now in the name of Jesus, Father, that you will give me the words of wisdom, the words of knowledge, the words of understanding. Father God, that you will give me utterance that I may open my mouth boldly and speak as you would have me to speak. Father God, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that your people will hear your voice. In my voice. Father God, I ask that you will use this word this morning to speak into people's lives, to speak into their situations, to speak into their circumstances, Father God. Father God, I pray that this body will be edified, built up, strengthened, refreshed, and revived in the inner man. Holy Spirit, have your way. I thank you for what you're going to do in advance in Jesus' name. If you believe it, say amen. For I am the Lord, and I change not. I was like, man, what title can I put on this message? People like titles, you know? So I put on, don't change, a change is coming. Don't change, a change is coming. Don't change, a change is coming. I'd like to thank Bishop and Pastor Allison also for the awesome opportunity to come, the awesome responsibility to come and minister to this great congregation. I want to minister on the God that does not change. Amen. You know, there are many attributes that the Lord possesses. Attribute means a quality or a feature regarded as a characteristic or an inherent part of someone or something. We know that God, he's a God of love, he's a God of mercy, that he's a God of compassion, that he's a God of forgiveness, and he has power. And it's because of our understanding of God's character that we are able to have faith when things are in our lives go contrary to his word. So listen, when you deal with sickness, you know that God is a healer. So despite sickness and disease that tries to attach itself to your body, your faith attaches itself to the character of God, knowing that God's character is not for you. Listen, it's not going to line up with you being sick. Listen, when you're dealing with a financial situation or a financial circumstance, your faith attaches to the character of God, that God is a provider, that God will supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. You see, we know the character of God. That's why we don't have to dismay when the whole world is going crazy in chaos, because we know it does not, listen, show the character of Almighty God. God is a good God. God is a great God. God is an awesome God. And God is still sitting on the throne. God is still. Listen, the Bible says that the earth is the Lord's footstool. So why all these people think they're in control and creating chaos and mayhem and the devil doing this and that? God is sitting in the heavens looking down and saying, y'all don't know who's in control. A parent may be late picking up their child, but the child does not commit suicide because that child knows that the parent loves them. So that child is able to wait patiently because they know it's only a matter of time before the ride shows up. Look at your neighbor and say, it's only a matter of time. I'm not going to flip out. I'm not going to lose my mind. I'm not going to commit spiritual suicide. I know it's only a matter of time before what God promised to me is going to show up in my life. Yeah, I may be waiting, but the ride is eventually going to show up in my life because that is the character of God. Not to leave me hanging, not to leave me overnight. God is going to pick me up and turn my life around. So this morning, I want to focus on the attribute of God, the main attribute. And the attribute I want to focus on is he is the God that does not change. He is the God that does not change. You know, it's hard to grasp this truth about God not changing because everything around us is constantly changing. Seasons change. People change. Finances change, circumstances change, everything around us is always changing. But I come to tell you this morning that God is the very thing in your life that will never change. Steadfast, unmovable, unwavering. You don't got to worry about getting up in the bed, out of the bed in the morning wondering, is God going to bless me? Is God for me? Listen, he's going to bless you today, tomorrow, the next day, 5 months from now, 5 years from now. God does not change. The Lord is the only one in your life that will never change. He won't change in the morning. He won't change in the night. He won't change in the month of July. He won't change in August. He won't change when you're surrounded by people. He won't change, listen, when you're all alone. He's the God that does not change. Wow, that's good news. That something in our life will not change. That's why Jesus Christ has to be the foundation of your faith. You can't have your faith in, listen, politics. You can't have your faith in a man. You can't have a faith in your wife, in your husband. You better put your faith in the foundation of Jesus Christ. You know what a foundation is. A foundation is the very thing that we're sitting on, listen, right now, Sunday morning in this church. Yeah, we're in a building, but under this building is a foundation that has been laid. And listen, you could come here tomorrow and the foundation is still there. You could come here a year from now and the foundation will still be there. And listen, God is the foundation in our life. He is the thing that will not change. Listen, you can set anything on top of it. A hurricane could come in and blow this building to smithereens, but the foundation will still remain intact. God is our foundation that will never change. You better not put your faith in yourself. Some people put their faith in themselves. I can do it. You can't do nothing. You look what your best thinking got you. You better put your faith in the foundation that'll never move, never be shaken. You know I don't trust myself? I don't trust myself. Heck no, I put my faith in Jesus to control me, to lead me, to guide me, to keep me in check. I don't even trust myself. Go to James chapter 1. Let y'all do some work. James chapter 1. And I can get a breather. Listen, people, you know, I could come in here with some, but listen, I come in here and I preach with passion and fire because God delivered me out of a situation that was not some Sunday morning altar, just simple, oh, I'll accept Jesus as my Lord. No, my life had been taken over by powers of darkness, powers, listen, that had take complete control of my life. And listen, Jesus Christ, listen, was the only one that could deliver and set my life free. Listen, people tried to set me free. I tried to set myself free, but Jesus Christ was the one that set me free. And listen, anything I do for him, I'm going to do with a passion. I'm going to do with fire. I'm going to do with vigor. I'm not coming here with some lackadaisy, oh, when's he going to be done sermon? Listen, I'm coming with the raw, uncut, listen, word of God. So I preach from the place, listen, that because I know what God has done in my life. That's why we tell brothers in the faith home, listen, your relationship with God, listen, cannot be lackadaisical. Your relationship with God cannot be some weak, lip-wristed relationship with God. The same way you were running after drugs and alcohol up night and day and listen, not taking a bath, not caring about your life, and nobody could stop you. Nobody could tell you anything. That's the way you need to run after the Lord. You need a passion in this thing. You see, if you don't have that passion, you're a ticking time bomb. You're a ticking time bomb because the enemy knows he's playing a game. He's not really serious. And I got those same appetites and desires waiting for him when he walks out the gate. And listen, you know, if you don't have an appetite or a desire greater than the appetites and desire that had you in bondage, it's only a matter of time for you'll return back to that bondage. You better have a desire and a passion for God that trumps the appetites and desires that you had for the things of the world. Or you're only a ticking time bomb, only a matter of time before you explode back into the man that you used to be. We see it around here all the time. Listen, it ain't about doing 18 months. Come on now. You can do 18 months and still not be changed. Yes. You can do 18 months and think you all that and walk out on the right off the stage from graduation and fall right on your face when you walk out the doors. Come on. It's not about 18 months. It's about getting on fire. I'm passion for the Lord. Yeah. That's the only thing that's going to keep you. Yeah. Devil don't care about 18 months. He wants to know what you got on the inside of you. What's on the inside of you? Jesus said the prince of this world cometh, but he has nothing in me. He has nowhere to attach to me. What's on the inside of you? Where were we at? James. Now I see people just poo-pooing their relationship with God, kicking it down the road like kicking an empty can, and just keep treating their relationship with God like nothing. Okay, sirrah, sirrah, whatever it be, will be. You better get some fire. You better get some fire. You better pray, God, set me on fire for you. Father, let burn up everything in me that is not like you, that is not of you. Lord, don't let me leave this place the same. Let me leave change. I don't care about all the stuff that's going on. I did not come here to change the lighthouse. I came here to get changed. I came here to get fixed. Yes. These people were doing this thing before I came. They're going to be doing it after I leave. God, change me. You waste your time putting out fires God never told you to put out. You running off. You waste your time putting out fires God never told you to put out. Don't waste your time putting out fires that the Lord never told you to put out. Because you'll blink and you didn't even, man, I didn't get me. I was too busy trying to help everybody else and change the government. I missed me. I didn't get what I came for. And the clock is ticking. I don't know why I'm ministering over on that end. That wasn't in my notes. That wasn't in my notes. But listen, you got to get on fire. He's like, yo, I'm doing good in class. I'm getting A. I'm getting this. I'm doing good on tests. I ain't getting in trouble. That don't mean nothing. Do you have fire? Do you have passion? Do you have fire? Are you being changed by the glory of God? That's the question. We don't care. Yeah, we want you to do good on that. But listen, the test is, are you getting changed on the inside? Listen, we're tired of seeing people do 18 months and leave out here and fall on their face. You might, if you're going to do this, go now. Hit the bottom and then come on back. Come on, guys, girls. Come on, let's get focused. Remember what God delivered you from? I don't dwell in the past, but I remember the jail cell. I remember, listen, getting shot at. I remember being broke, busted in the sky. I remember that state I was in before the Lord. So I'm not going to get so high up that I forget the pit that God delivered me from. Wake up! Somebody needs to wake up this morning. You're being distracted with irrelevant things. Wake up. Your life is on the line. You think it's your thoughts in your mind, and it's the devil soliciting you to get you out of the will of God. Look what your best thinking got you. James 1, thank you. Verse 16. God will interrupt notes to speak to somebody. God will interrupt this whole, rip this whole thing up to speak to his children that's about to make a stupid mistake or that's drifting off the path. He'll interrupt it. Okay, James 1, 16. It says, do not err, my beloved brethren. Every good, every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Look at what the Bible says. Do not err. Every good, every perfect gift is from above and come down from the Father of lights. You get into error when you think that God is changing out of his character. His character is every good and every perfect gift is from the Father. If you think that something is in your life and it was originated from God and it is not good and perfect, you're in error. And the Bible says, don't get in error. Stay, listen in the truth that God is a good God, that God is a faithful God. Listen, this is the test to tell what's of God in your life. Jesus said, I come to give you life and life more abundantly. He said, the thief cometh to kill, steal, and destroy. So that is the MO of God. That is the MO of the devil. That Jesus came to give me life. The devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy. You got that? So listen, don't say something's God. Listen, if it's not lining up with the MO of God, the mode of operation of God. Listen, if something is coming to kill, steal, and destroy, that is the devil. All the stuff that's going on right now in our nation is of the devil. It's not bringing peace. It's bringing division. It's bringing hatred. Don't be deceived, church. It's the MO of the enemy. Do not err. James said, do not get into error. Keep thinking that and knowing that God is a good God God is going to bless me. God is going to do me good and make me happy. God has an awesome plan for my life. God is going to get me out of this mess. God is going to deliver me. God is going to provide for me. God is going to heal me. Don't move into error and say, oh, maybe God's trying to teach me a lesson. The lesson is right here. He said, just read the book. No, wait a minute. Let me preface this now. Okay. Now, if you don't do this, hold on. If you don't do this, unfortunately, life becomes the teacher. Anybody ever been taught by life? Put two hands, two feet, flip up in the air. Anybody been taught by life? Anybody tried to tell you something? You said, I know what I'm going to do, and I'm going to do it no matter what you tell me. And then life had to put the spank on you for you to come back and say, you know what, my God, I know now. I learned my lesson. You ever heard somebody say, I learned my lesson? Usually that's after you got a whipping. I learned my lesson. I came here in 99. I learned my lesson. I got whipped. I mean, where I came running back to the Lord. I came running to the Lord. Like, Lord, oh, my, I was like, you ever get whipped by your dad? Ah! I used to overreact. Ah! He didn't even hit me. Ah! I ain't even hit you yet. You scream. I was like, man, is this a new bell or something? God, I didn't even touch him. My God. Jeez. Faith belt. My God. Don't get into error. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever had people change the way they thought about you? Have you ever had people change the way they thought about you? And subconsciously you thought that God also changed his opinion about you. Now listen, it does not matter if everyone on the planet changes the way that they feel about you. God has not changed his opinion about you. God still loves you. God still thinks you're all that. When nobody's calling, he's going to be the one calling you up. When all your friends leave you and forsake you, God is still going to be on your side. God will never change. And don't think because people change on you that that is exemplifying God changing on you. God does not change. God is not bound by my opinion about you or that person's opinion about you. God's mind is already made up about you. Yeah. His mind is already made up, and there's nothing that you can do to change it. That's right. It's already made up. He has God. Listen, God is not double-minded. God has a made-up mind. He's not scratching his head like, man, this guy. I've been there, done something stupid. People change their opinion about you. People leave you, abandon you, leave you hanging. And subconsciously, you can begin to think that God is in the car with them, leaving too. He ain't in the car with them. He's right there with you. He ain't left. He's with you. Man, that's so sad. They all left. I ain't going nowhere. I'm with you, buddy. Everybody's taking off. God didn't take off. He didn't get in the car. You're there crying, and God is right there with you. He still thinks you're all that. He is the only one that can say and fulfill these words, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Let me say that again. He's the only, yeah, but my mama told me she'd never leave me nor forsake me. My husband and my wife told me they'd never leave me or forsake me. Let me say it again. He is the only one that can say and fulfill these words, I will never leave you nor forsake you. People will say they will never leave you or forsake you, but they are lying because that confession is based on current favorable circumstances. I'll never leave you or forsake you. That's because you're doing everything right. The minute you start acting crazy, the minute you have a Jekyll and Hyde moment, the minute you turn into the Incredible Hulk and start, what? They're going to leave you. They might forsake you. They're lying. They're saying that based on favorable current circumstances. I'll never leave you, man. It's because you're doing everything right. Yo, you're making the money. You're doing this. You're doing that. Yo, I'll never leave you, man. All right, turn into somebody. Turn into the scariest villain you can think of. And I guarantee you, some X-Men bad guy or something. Turn into one of them guys. And I guarantee you, that confession will be out the window. They're gone. But I thought you said you would never leave me nor forsake me. I can't say that. Only God can say that. He's got it in his word. I will never leave you nor forsake. Now, I'll be there for you when you turn, when the Incredible Hulk turns back into, what's his name?
Dr. Banner.
Dr. Banner. When you come back, come to your senses. Prodigal son, when you come back to your senses, we'll be at the Father's house waiting for you. But the Hulk got to stay out there. He tear. You ever see? Don't the Hulk tear stuff up? Bam, bam, bam. I mean, my, nobody can stop this guy. And a lot of us, we've turned into the Incredible Hulk on our loved ones and tore everything up. And you don't get mad at them because they left or kicked you out the house. You're about to bust everything up in here. Man, that guy, he tears some stuff up, man. Anybody identify with that? Used to tear some stuff up? So the minute you start acting like the fool, they will quickly depart from you. I come this morning to strengthen your faith, to give you an insurance that you are never alone. Your God, my God, will never change. There are people who think that because they missed the mark, that God has changed his mind about them. God's blessing on your life is not performance-based, it's faith-based. Let me say that again. God's blessing on your life is not performance-based, it's faith-based. Faith in the finished work of Jesus is what qualifies you for the blessed life. Now go to Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11. Woo, I thank the Lord he never changes. I'm telling you, man, I blew it royally, man. I thought God ain't even going to want nothing to do with me. And in the midst of my foolishness, I had a visitation from the Lord. And he said, I have not given up on you. I still want to do something awesome in your life. Don't think that. It wasn't even a prayer. It's almost like he could sense my thoughts. And he had to quickly interrupt those thoughts to let me know, don't compare me to what people think about you. Romans 11, 29. Romans 11, 29. Listen to this. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. Let me say it again. For the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. I want to read it out in Amplified. Listen to this. For the gifts and callings of God are irrevocable. For he does not withdraw what he has given, nor does he change his mind about those to whom he gives his grace or to whom he sends his call. They're irrevocable, the gifts and callings. He does not withdraw it. Ah, you're acting crazy. I take it back. Ah, you're not worthy. I'll take it back. Ah, you didn't do everything I told you to do. I'll take it back. For he does not withdraw what he has given, nor does he change his mind. Oh, you acting crazy. I changed my mind about all that good stuff I told you I was going to do for you. He says, I do not change my mind about those to whom he gives his grace or to whom he sends his call. Man, ain't that good news? That was good news for a guy like me that blew it. He does not change his mind about those to whom he gives his grace or to whom he sends his call. Now, I thought about this, and I had to tap into another attribute to God, which actually gave me a greater understanding of God's mercy and his compassion. The attribute, other attribute that God has is God is omniscient. That means he's all-knowing, that he knows the beginning, he knows it all the way to the end, and he knows everything that's going to happen in between. So wait a minute. He's the God that gives grace. He's the God that calls an individual, but at the same time, he has foreknowledge of that individual's life and all-knowing of every choice and decision that that individual is going to make, and still, he's not intimidated. He still sends his call in, even though he already seen, watch your movie in advance. Let me say that again. He watched your movie in advance, popped in the DVD. Let's see how this life is going to play out. Ooh. Ooh. My God. Oh, he got back up right there. Ooh, again. My God. Ooh, Jesus. What do you think? You know what? Let's do it. And he calls you after he watched your video, after he watched your life played out. He still sent his call. He still called you. And he said, man, I'm not going to change my mind. My mind was already made up before I called. My mind was already made up before you made a mistake. My mind was already made up, even with me having foreknowledge. My mind is already made up. I'm not going to change my mind on you. This message was actually inspired. I wasn't even praying. I had been thinking and thinking about some things I'm believing God for, and I'm like, oh, maybe he changed his mind about that. In my mind, I'm thinking that, or maybe it got adjusted or this or that. And then we were in the back of the service one day, all just talking on a Wednesday service, and Bishop, he turned around. We were talking about something else, and he just turned. He said, God never changes. And when he said that, it was like, you know, I say, God, let them hear your voice and my voice. I heard God's voice in his voice. And basically, all them questions I had in my mind, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, Tone, I don't change. I don't change. If I said I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it. I'm not going to change. Don't worry about it. I'm not going to change. So this actually came out of that, and that happened a few months ago. God does not bless you and then you do something stupid and say, I changed my mind. Look at the way they're acting. I'll take my grace back. Now, listen, I'm not giving you permission to go and act stupid. There are a lot of people that were called and did not walk in the call because maybe their decision or their choice cut their life short. So, listen, I'm not endorsing that in any way, but I want you to, I'm coming from the God angle. Listen, I'm talking to people that maybe in your mind, you're thinking that, man, some of my mistakes I've done, maybe God has adjusted or altered his plan in my life. And I come to tell you tonight that no, he has not adjusted it. He has not altered it. It's the same plan. And you're saying, there's somebody saying that, but you don't understand what I did. And I'm here to tell you, you don't understand what Jesus did. If you're comparing what you did, forget that. You need to look at what Jesus did. Now, listen, what Jesus did trumps what you did. Your thing ain't even an equation. God, matter of fact, said, I forget your sins and iniquities no more. Think about what Jesus did. Don't worry about what you did, because you're going to do something stupid again. So you need to focus on what Jesus did. I wish I could tell you, even after getting up, you're gonna make mistakes. But come on, he never changes. Now listen, I don't want to act like God is some mechanical robot that is not affected when we mess up or this or that. Or he's locked into a mechanical position. Go to Psalms 138. Psalms 138. The God that never changes. He said, I am the Lord and I change not. Psalms 138, and let's take a look at verse number 2. Psalms 138, verse 2. It says, I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth, for thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. He said he has magnified his word above his name. God has bound himself to his word. God knows that your name is only good as your word. Your name is only good as your word. That's why the Bible says a good name is better chosen than great riches. So God said, you know what? I want my name to be great in the earth. I want when my name comes up that they know that, listen, I am a supernatural being of integrity that never changes, that is consistent. So I'm going to bow myself to my word. That means I'm not going to do anything contrary to my word. So listen, if you're thinking that God is doing something contrary to his word, you're off. You're way off. You don't have to go here. You can write it down for your notes. In Psalms 89:34, God says, my covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. So listen, he says, ladies and gentlemen, my sons, my daughters, I'm not going to break my covenant. Got any married people in the house? Amen. Amen. Listen, when you get married, I think people need to pay a more attention to the vows that's exchanged than all the decorations. Because they pack them decorations up after the wedding and you don't see them again. But those vows are designed to set a standard for that marriage for the long course. And listen, when God got into covenant relationship with you, as far as he's concerned, you and him are married. And God, listen, says, I hate divorce. God says, I despise divorce. God even said to his prophet Hosea, I want to show you the power of my love. I want you to go marry a harlot. I want you to go marry a hooker. I want you to go into downtown Tampa and pick up a hooker and marry her. And then I want you, when she's unfaithful to you, to not break the covenant that you have made with her. And I want to show you my love that I have for my people. That listen, even when they're unfaithful, even when they miss the mark, I'm not going to break my covenant. I'm not going to break this marriage up. You got yourself back in bondage. I will come down and listen. They're trying to bid you off. I'll be the higher bidder to get you off the slavery block once again. That's the God that you and I serve. That even when you turn into an harlot and become unfaithful to him, he's not going to utter the words, I want a divorce. I'm not going to change. You may change. People may change. But I am not going to change. I am the Lord, and I change not. Hebrews 6:13 says, when God made promise to Abraham because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely blessing, I will bless you, and multiplying, I will multiply you. So after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. Listen to this. For men verily swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation to them is an end of all strife. When you swear, don't you usually swear on the Bible? I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God. Wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of the promise the humility, or it means the unchangeableness of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things it is impossible for God to lie, that he might have a strong consolation who have fled to lay up the hope that is set before us. Basically, God said, man, I can't find nothing greater than me. You know what? I'm going to put up a mirror. God, you took a promise to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth. I do. Amen. Help me, God. That's why the Bible says that heaven and earth will pass away before his word will ever pass away. Because he swore by himself. Man, if I alter this thing, I'll cease. That's it. End of the story. So he swore by himself. I don't think God would set himself up to have heaven and earth pass away. I think he's going to be watching. I think that's why the Bible says he watches over his word to perform it. His eyes go to and fro throughout the earth, looking to move on a man or woman that's holding up the word of God and say, God, you promised me that you would do this. You promised me that you would deliver me. You promised me that you would make this right. You promised me that you would heal me. You promised me that you would supply this need. He watches over his word to perform it. He swore by himself. When we think God has changed, we are tempted to change or even give up on what we're believing for. People are tempted to think that God has changed when, one, they missed the mark, two, when a lot of time has passed, and three, when unexpected life circumstances pop up out of nowhere. Now, listen, I kind of like already elaborated on when you missed the mark, that he ain't going to change on you. And the example I wrote down was in John 21, when Jesus, after the disciples left him hanging, after the rooster crowed three times, after the death, burial, and resurrection, he still showed up on the beach and said, guys, won't you come dine with me? Come on now. Who would you invite some people over that left you hanging, forsake you in your toughest hour, left, and now you cook this huge dinner and said, come dine with me. Jesus showing you his faithfulness in that he already had knowledge of what they were going to do and said, I still have set up a table in the presence of your enemies. So when you miss the mark, God still hasn't changed. Them disciples, they missed the mark royally. And he still didn't change on them. He still said, I give you power. I give you this. Go to Jerusalem. After all they did, go to Jerusalem and tarry and wait for the power. Still gave them all these promises after they blew it and left the man hanging. So listen, when you miss the mark, don't think that God has changed. Galatians 6:1 says, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you who are spiritual, restore one is in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. If this is the way God is telling us to treat one another, then it's the way he's going to treat us. You know, it's a parallel to what God says in his word, that how we're supposed to treat one another. He's not going to tell you to do something that he's not going to do himself. I find out the character of God by how he tells me to treat you. That's how he's going to treat me and you. Next one, the time. Time. When a lot of time has passed, we begin to subconsciously think that, well, man, maybe God changed his mind. Time has a way of wearing down our faith. Sometimes you feel like you're walking through a time desert. You're walking it out, but you are not seeing anything but miles and miles of the same old scenery. You get to a high place and you think things are about to change, and then it's another phase of the same thing. I come this morning to tell you, don't let time make you think that God has changed. He's not changed. God has not changed. Listen, Abraham let time change him and created Ishmael. God told him how it was supposed to happen. Because it did not happen right away, he tried to expedite the process and created a mess. Have you ever seen somebody trying to make something happen and make a mess? You'd be like, man, you're moving too fast. No, I got this. You're moving too. Slow down, man. Take it easy. I got this. Some people just ain't going to listen to you. Don't ever put a date stamp on what you're believing God for. In 6 months, if it don't happen, I'm out. Don't do that. I don't know when it's going to happen, but it's going to happen. And while I'm waiting, he's doing something in me to prepare me for it. That's my thought process on that. So listen, don't let time wear your faith down. All the promises of God are yes and amen. So don't let time. I know, because I talk to people. They're like, man, when's this thing going to show up? When's this thing going to break through? He's working on you. If it hasn't showed up, that means he's working on you. There's something that you need to grow in, an area you need to grow in before you receive that. It's coming. Okay, the next one, last one. I got to get the choir up here. They got some stuff to do. Okay, so the next one, unexpected events. Real quickly, in John 16:33, Jesus said, in the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Jesus said you would experience turbulence, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. Just like a pilot navigates an airplane through rough winds. Anybody ever been on a plane through turbulence? Now listen, I don't know about you, but when you feel that thing, don't your heart like drop too? But the thing that I notice on a plane that keeps you encouraged is the pilot comes on and says, excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, we are hitting some rough weather. The fasten your seatbelt sign is on. Please buckle up. But we're going to get right through this. Just sit back and enjoy the ride. All right. And then you get back eased. Go back listening or watching whatever you were watching. And listen, then he comes on again and tells you, all right, we made it out. You can take your seatbelts back off. That's why when you're going through something, you got to hear from God. When you're going through unexpected things, it's good to hear the voice of God. In your spirit, son, daughter, I got this. Don't worry about it. You can stay in rest. You can stay in peace. You don't have to go out and try to fix this. I got it. I'm driving the plane. Just ride. Brace yourself. Now, sometimes you got to brace yourself. You might have to get prayed up. You might have to get up a little early. You might have to do some fasting. But you're going to make it through. Okay, last scripture. y'all out of here. James 1 says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask God, who gives to men all liberally without reproach, and it will be given to him. So listen, when you fall into trials and temptations, listen, know that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its work, that you may be perfect and entire, lacking. I say this, and then I'll close. You got it, what it takes on the inside of you to outlast anything you're going through. You have enough in you. The devil may have, man, I can keep this pressure up for 5 days, and I know that in 5 days they'll break up on the fourth day. No, you got enough in you to make it through it and make it out of that thing. Let patience have her perfect work, that you can be perfect and entire, one another. And listen, when you come out of it, you say, God, I'm ready for payday. I'm ready to get paid through all that mess I just went through. Yes, amen? Amen. I'm done. Hallelujah. Give up. Give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. We're going to transition now to this is Family Matters Sunday, so we got the Faith Home Choir coming to sing, and turn it over to you, Brother Lewis.
Awesome word, right? Let me go up here. Today's Faith Home Sunday, and today we expound on the importance of seed. And today it's going to be an offering. We're going to call up Gary Mize to come up and talk about what God's done in his life through the Faith Home.
Can I get some help with the mics? Good morning. My name's Gary Mize. Just want to come up and tell you all a little bit about myself and what God's done for me through the Faith Home. Right now, I'm 36 years old right now. I spent over 20 years of my life bound to alcohol and drugs. From 13 years old all the way to 31 years old, horrible times, crazy times, but I didn't know God. I didn't know anything about God. And there's enough about that, because y'all can just imagine what I went through. But I thank God for blessing my life. I came to the Faith Home. He sent me to the Faith Home, called me out. Thank God he called me out, brought me out of the darkness into his light here at the Faith Home. Changed my life, changed my family's life forever, for everything. I don't think the same way I used to think. I don't see the world the same way I used to see the world. And it's all because of the Faith Home and what it did in my life. And allowing myself to have that relationship that Pastor Tony was talking about, that real deep relationship with Jesus Christ. I wasn't perfect. I wasn't perfect in the Faith Home, trust me. I mean, I didn't get in much trouble, but I wasn't perfect. I didn't get straight A's on all my tests, none of that stuff like that. But I made sure every day that I encouraged the other brothers, and I made sure that my relationship with Jesus Christ was the very first thing every single day, just like I do today. I wake up in the morning, I thank God. There's days where I go by, I might not talk to God all day long, but when I wake up in the morning, I thank God every single day. And I still, it's crazy, because there'll be times where I just, at the end of the day, I'll lay down and I'll realize every move that I made was not based on my own understanding. It was based on God's understanding and the faith walk that I walk with God every single day. I just encourage y'all, friends, family, to give into this ministry. This ministry is very powerful for myself, all the families, all the people that are impacted by what happens here in the Faith Home, it's amazing. It's an amazing thing. It's something you can see. It's something you can touch. You can feel when you see your family member go through the 18 months of the Faith Home, and you just watch God. You watch them grow in God. You watch the things that happen in their life. It's right there in front of you. You can see it. You can touch it. You can feel it. You can literally watch God shine through your family, and it gets in your family, and it changes not only them, but it changes your family. I just challenge you right now to just give into the Faith Home. Do your best. If you've never sowed a seed into really anything, or you've never really trusted God to put a seed in out of faith and to believe in Him to make that seed grow and flourish right in front of your eyes, I challenge you to do that today, because I promise you, God will make that happen through what you give into the Faith Home. He will make that happen. You can watch this seed grow. This seed will not fall on rocks. This seed will not fall in the thorns and be choked out. This seed is falling on just unbelievable, great soil. Just unreal. It's almost hard for me to talk. I'm getting choked up right now, because I know, I've seen it, I live it every single day. It's amazing. It's alive. It is alive inside of me and my brothers, the men and women of the Faith Home. It's just amazing what God does in their lives. And it's all because of what we give and what we give into the Faith Home. If it wasn't for the friends, the family, the congregation, a lot of this cannot happen. We wouldn't be able to support and allow these things to just keep on flourishing, and God just keep on doing what He does, if it wasn't for what we do and what we give. Ushers, take your places. If y'all need an envelope, raise your hands. They will get one to you. I just encourage you right now, like I said, just give your best seed. Give whatever you can. It doesn't matter if you give a penny. It doesn't matter if you give $1,000. If you give it out of the goodness of your heart and what God has purposed in your heart, it will flourish in your life. Thank you very much.
Into order, who makes the orphan Hallelujah. Thank you, choir. Amen. Amen. Have y'all been blessed this morning? Hallelujah. Amen. We welcome you to, don't forget about Wednesday, being positive in a negative world. Amen. We're going to dismiss you at this time. We're going to have the prayer team up here after we dismiss. So if you need prayer, please feel free to come on up. Amen. Let's lift our hands up to the Lord. And don't, family matters in the chapel. Amen. Father, we just thank you this morning for your presence. Father, we thank you for your word. And Father, I pray the blessing over each one of your people. Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Amen. Be blessed.